Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. This is the second part of my vertical axis wind turbine series, and in this video I'm going to show you how to analyze the aerodynamics of a vertical axis wind turbine and talk about some of the design options to get around the challenges faced by the vertical axis wind turbines that I discussed in the previous video on this topic. So if you didn't look at that one yet, then you can check it out here. The basic idea of a vertical axis turbine is the same as a horizontal axis one. The wind exerts a force on the blades, which turns a shaft connected to a generator, which generates electricity. So I have talked before on this channel a lot about horizontal axis turbines and how their design evolution has kind of narrowed into a pretty standard design. But that's not the case for vertical axis wind turbines. There is still a huge range of variety, but they can be split into two broad categories, the drag type and the lift type, also known as Savonius and Darrieus type. So if you saw the video that I made on the design evolution of horizontal axis wind turbines, you might remember that the old-fashioned windmills used drag to push the sails around, and modern wind turbines use aerodynamic blades that create a lift force from the wind, which is a much more efficient way to capture energy from the wind. There are similar aerodynamics at play in vertical axis turbines. So for a given size of turbine, you should get a lot more power out of a lift type turbine than a drag type one. For vertical axis turbines where efficiency matters, like if you're trying to generate as much electricity as possible, you would choose a lift type turbine. To analyze these, we use the same aerodynamic theory as airplanes or horizontal axis turbines. It's just the orientation is different. So like I said before, there are really a lot of different configurations of vertical axis turbines. Sometimes the lift type machines are all lumped together and called Darrieus turbines. But the machine that Darrieus designed and patented in 1926 was of the egg beater type with curved blades. You can also have straight blades arranged so that they look like the letter H. These are known as H-type turbines. Or you can take the H shape and kind of twist the blades into a helical shape, so it looks a bit like a piece of DNA, and this will help reduce some of the problems with this type of turbine that I'll talk about later. In fact, people have made vertical axis turbines in pretty much every kind of shape you can think about. There's V configuration, delta configuration, diamond configuration, gyro mill configuration. You get the picture. All right, so there are heaps of different kinds of vertical axis turbines, but I'm going to choose the H-type arrangement to talk about the aerodynamics and the operating principle, just because I think that's the simplest to analyze. And it's also pretty common amongst the recent current commercial turbines. But you can apply the same method to the other types as well. It's just a bit more involved because you can't just make a single calculation for the whole blade length. You would need to split the blade into sections and analyze each one separately and then sum them up. Pretty much like we did in the BEM method for horizontal axis wind turbine analysis. So I'm just going to do a really simplified analysis here. I just want to show you the operating principles in enough detail to get the feeling for how it works and what some of the problems are. I will recommend a few books and papers that you can read to get a rigorous and correct analysis. And if you really want to see a video including all of the aerodynamic theory and the equations, then let me know in the comments and I'll try to make that happen. But warning, there'll be a lot of maths in that video. So we'll start by looking at a single blade. The basic aerodynamic principle, it's the same for an aeroplane or a horizontal axis turbine. The blade is an aerofoil, and when air flows over it, it creates a lift force perpendicular to the wind direction. A component of this force is in the right direction to create a torque that will rotate the shaft. So far, so good, and we have a simpler situation than in a horizontal axis turbine because the entire length of the blade sees the same local airflow speed and the same angle of attack. So this means the blade can be straight, more like an aeroplane wing, and it doesn't need to be twisted and tapered like a horizontal axis wind turbine blade does. But it is a bit more complex than that because the blade does rotate around its shaft axis, so the local airflow is affected by the rotational speed as well as the wind speed. And there is also some inflow to be taken into account, but I'm just ignoring that for today's really simplified analysis. So at different points in its path, the blade is oriented differently relative to the wind. You can add the wind speed and the rotational velocity vectors to find the local airflow speed and angle of attack, and then use trigonometry to resolve the lift and drag forces into normal and tangential components. So let's look at what happens as the rotor turns. We'll start with the blade on the downwind side of the rotor, so it's perpendicular to the wind direction, it's crossing the wind. We add the wind and blade velocity vectors and use trigonometry to find the resultant wind speed and angle of attack. And then you can resolve that to find the force acting in the tangential direction, which turns the rotor. As the blade turns further around, the angle of attack gets smaller, meaning the lift force and torque get smaller too. At 90 degrees, when the blade is parallel to the wind, there's no angle of attack. And assuming we have a symmetrical airfoil, then there's no lift, only a small drag force, which acts opposite to the direction of the rotation. So we have a small negative torque here. Then, as we rotate further, the angle of attack continues to decrease, so it's negative, making our lift force in the opposite direction relative to the blade. But since the blade is facing the other way now, we still have a component of that force creating a positive torque that will turn the rotor. Depending on the tip speed ratio, which is the ratio of the blade speed to the wind speed, you may or may not see the angle of attack go beyond the stall angle. And if that does happen, if the angle of attack exceeds the stall angle, then the flow separates, creating a violently swirling flow. In that case, the lift force suddenly decreases and the drag force suddenly increases, and this swirling, turbulent flow causes a lot of vibrations in the blade.
These constantly changing forces are the most challenging part of vertical axis turbine blade design, as they can cause several problems. The first is that it's very hard on the blade structure and the other turbine components to survive these loads. When loads change frequently, it's called fatigue loading, and just like the name suggests, fatigue loading can wear components out quickly, even if the forces themselves are small. It's the same effect as when you bend a paperclip repeatedly back and forth. Even small bends will eventually break the paperclip if you repeat them enough. A second consequence of the differing forces as the blade moves around its path is that the torque that the generator sees varies constantly. This is called torque ripple, and it causes problems for a lot of turbine components. It causes vibrations and noise and shortens the lifetime of the machine. And as well as causing problems for the generator, the fact that you have the most efficient angle of attack in just one location per rotation means that the rest of the time the blade is generating less torque than the optimal, so you have compromised efficiency. So that's what happens if you have the most simple design of a straight blade that's fixed at a certain angle. You have a very simple design, but two major problems: dynamic stall and severe fatigue loading that goes with that. And you also have reduced efficiency and torque ripple because the blade is only oriented optimally for a small portion of the rotation. But you can change the design slightly to reduce these problems. The dynamic stall behavior of vertical axis turbines has been the cause of a lot of failures for vertical axis turbines over the years. Early vertical axis turbine blades were mostly made of aluminium, and the fatigue loads were perhaps not very well understood at the time, which led to a lot of early failures of vertical axis blades, which kind of caused a widespread assumption that this is just an inherent problem with vertical axis wind turbines. But modern composite materials like fiberglass and carbon fiber, and analysis tools like CFD and FEA, together with the experience of early failures, have helped to reduce these issues a lot. So another design option to mitigate issues with fatigue loading is to make the blades in the egg beater shape of the Darrieus turbine. This arrangement means the blades are loaded nearly exclusively in tension, which suits composite materials very well because they perform much better in tension than compression. So a composite structure loaded only in tension can be really light. So far, we only looked at a single blade. Adding more blades will reduce the variability of the output, as not all of the blades will stall at the same time. But you'd need a pretty large number of blades to totally eliminate the torque variation, and then that would get expensive. You can achieve a similar effect by making the blades helical. So there is a section of the blade at every location along the circumference. So the torque that that kind of a turbine would produce should be a lot more constant than one with straight blades. But of course, the manufacturing complexity for these like double helix shaped wind turbines is a lot higher than for a simpler straight bladed design. Another way to reduce torque variation is to control the blade pitch. So instead of rigidly fixing the blades in place, you would allow them to pitch to keep the local angle of attack close to the most efficient one. This approach means that the torque is a lot more constant, and it can also increase the efficiency a lot compared to a fixed blade. And there's no need for the blades to ever stall, so you should decrease the fatigue loading the blades are subjected to, potentially making the structural design simpler. But of course, to get this extra efficiency and simpler structural design, we need to add complexity to achieve it in the form of a fast responding active control, for example. In my opinion, this active blade pitch control is the most promising way to improve vertical axis wind turbine design. It's probably too complex to be cost effective for small turbines, but for large ones, I think that if any vertical axis turbine is going to become widespread, it's going to be one with this kind of technology. My take on vertical axis turbines is that they can be simpler, but in their simpler configuration, they are less efficient. And so usually designers end up trying to increase efficiency, and in doing that, they increase complexity. So we end up with designs that are not necessarily any less complex than horizontal axis machines. So I don't think that they're going to replace utility scale horizontal axis turbines, but they could fill niches that horizontal axis turbines don't suit. So this kind of niche might be distributed generation, places where noise is an issue, and maybe off-grid installations in places that have turbulent wind conditions. But what do you think? Do you like vertical axis turbines for any specific locations? Do you think that there are advantages or disadvantages that I didn't mention here? And don't forget to tell me if there's a specific type of vertical axis turbine that you'd like me to look into in a future video. You can find lots of other wind turbine design videos on my channel, plus a lot of other clean energy technologies. So don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.